the spotlight and kind of, you know, made that spotlight a lot bigger for like the police and all that kind of FBI to kind of look at you more heavily. What was that list called? What am I referring to here?
It was Fortune Magazine's list. It was written in 86, and it was the 50 biggest and wealthiest mob bosses in the country. And I was actually the youngest guy on the list. It was the top 50, and I was number 18 at that time. And they featured me in the article saying, you know, that I was the biggest money maker or whatever. Another magazine said I was the biggest money maker since Al Capone for the mob. You know, I don't pay much attention to that. I did what I did, and I made a lot of money for myself and for other people. You know, it didn't do me well as far as the government was concerned, because it put me, you know, a bullseye on my back, and I paid the price for that. But, you know, it was interesting.
So how much money were you actually making at the time? And I'm just kind of thinking, too, how did they, Fortune, ever even figure out how much money you were making? Did they have some kind of informants leaking that stuff to them?
Yeah, well, you know, there were a lot of informants started to pop up in the mid-80s. And, you know, unfortunately, I was a target of many of them because, you know, when the government wants you, you know, you're a meal ticket for people to get out of jail or to reduce their sentence or not to get indicted, a lot of different things. But, you know, my combined operations at that time, the gas tax scheme being the biggest, I was bringing in, you know, $5, $8, $10 million a week, depending upon the week and the gross and the volume and all of that. So, I mean, I earned pretty heavily at the time.
And you were so young too. How did this tax thing actually work? The tax fraud thing. Can you kind of walk us through that? Not super detailed maybe, but just kind of an overview of how that works.
Well, you know, at the height of my operation, I had 18 companies that were licensed to collect tax on every gallon of gasoline. We were wholesalers, and I had a connection to get the licenses. And it was a political connection, and I paid for it. And that's how I was able to get 18 licenses. And basically, you know, in its very simplest terms, and obviously it was complicated to accomplish this, but in the simplest terms, we were licensed to collect the tax on every gallon of gasoline. We were then responsible to pay the government on a quarterly basis. And we devised a scheme to collect the taxes, not pay the government, and not get caught or audited for almost a year. So for every license, I got almost a year of collecting big money on tax and not paying the government before they came in and tried to close the company down. So, you know, the plan was simple. The execution was a bit more complicated, and that involved accountants and, you know, storage tanks and a lot of different stuff that we used to get the year. Because we wanted at least 10 months to a year on every license. When the government finally did come down on us, well, we just closed that operation and started working out of the next license. And so it was a daisy chain. It just kept going. Put different people in different places, different offices, you know, so they could never catch up with us.
Yeah. So you didn't even care about the license at all. You were just going for that 1 year, like, push to get as much money as you could and then just go on to the next thing.
That was it. You know, we again, the scheme was in getting a year out of the license or as close to it as possible as we can before the government came down on us. And we perfected that.
Yeah. So when you're making all that money, $5 to $10 million a week, and you're in like your mid-20s, that obviously makes you look pretty good. And, you know, the boss is, who's the boss at the time? Is it still Columbo?
No, Columbo had been shot. He was seriously wounded. He eventually died from wounds. We had two bosses at that time. The real one was Carmine Persico, who recently passed away in prison. And then while he was in prison, the acting boss was a fellow by the name of Tom DiBella. And Tom has passed on now, too. So they were the two bosses that I answered to.
Okay. And so you're making $5 to $10 million a week. I don't think anyone else is coming close to that. Like, your contemporaries, people that are on like your same level, does that automatically boost your status in their eyes? And did that lead to you becoming a captain soon thereafter?
Yeah, I was appointed a captain as a result of, you know, the money I was bringing in and the fact that I was a good soldier. I mean, I followed orders. I did what I had to do and I brought in money. I mean, you follow orders and you bring in money and, you know, and you don't get on the wrong end of the right people. Or the wrong people, I should say, and you rise in the ranks. And that's what happened with me.
Cool.
So, you know, I knew how to navigate that life at that time. I was bringing in a lot of money. So In 1980, I was appointed the position of capo de gene. And that's, you know, it's a boss because you get men assigned to you, other made men. You have a lot of associates. So a lot of people are answering to you. So it's not the boss of the family, but it's called the street boss. You know, you're out there and you, you know, you report only to the boss at that.
How many people are in the entire family, like your entire Colombo family? And then how many people are you in charge? How many captains are there? And then how many are like each captain in charge of?
Well, you know, it varies from family to family, but, and from time to time, but at that time in the 80s, we had about 115 made guys that actually took the oath in the Colombo family. I believe we had 15 or 16 capo de gene captains at that time. And each one of us had, you know, 10, 15 men that were assigned to us. And some of us could have had bigger crews, some less. And then we had associates. Now, you know, I had a couple of hundred associates under me because the gas tax business brought me a lot of people. And I was pretty diverse. I had a lot of different things going on. So I had people that were associated with me that were under my command, so to speak.
Yeah. A couple hundred of those associates, are those people you would actually trust at all, or are they just people you did business with and they knew who you were?
Well, they were responsible to me and I was responsible to them. If they were to get in trouble or do something wrong, or, you know, they had to answer to me for it. So was I best friends with all of them? No. You know, I only had my inner circle that I was really close to, but, you know, these guys were known as part of the Franzese crew. So they, you know, they were under my umbrella, so to speak.
Okay. And out of that, like 5 to 10 million that you're pulling in every week from the idea that you came up with, the gas tax fraud, which is, you know, your genesis, your baby, how much of that 5 to 10 million a week are you actually taking home and keeping yourself? Like, I know there's a lot of kickups and like you have to pay a lot of people off. How much are you actually taking home?
Well, let's put it this way. I was doing pretty good. You know, I can't give you the exact number, but you know, I was taking care of a lot of people also. And I was paying the family for their end of it. I had a lot of people working for me, but, you know, look, I had my own jet plane. I had a helicopter at that point. Wow. I mean, I built a 7,500 square foot home in Long Island on 2 acres of land, you know, and I had a house in Florida, a house in Marina Del Rey, California. So, I mean, I was doing well and no complaints at all. And the money just kept coming in.
Yeah. How long did that scheme last for? A few years or like just a short
time? I ran it for close to 8 years.
Oh, wow. Wow.
Yeah. And I had the Russians involved with me from Brighton Beach. So, you know, we had a lot of people working at the time.
Yeah. So how does that actually work? That's interesting you brought that up. There's not just the Italian mafia, which is probably the most well-known and probably, from my guess, the most powerful. There's also all kinds of other people like the Russian mob, the Irish mob. I'm out in Boston, actually Taunton, which is south of Boston. There's like a Portuguese mafia that, you know, isn't as big, but they're affiliated with a lot of people, probably Italian mafia too. There's like so many different ones, even like the Chinese mob. You go to like Chinatown. Did you guys associate with those guys? Did you do a lot of business with those guys? Was it like a lot of gang rivalry? Like you guys killing each other because you're kind of like going for turf and stuff like that? Like how did that work back in your time?
Yeah, that's a lot of stuff you see in the movies. We didn't have wars with other groups like that. The Russians, you know, they were pretty well located in Brighton Beach and they had a small gas operation at the time. So I just brought them into our fold. They were great partners. And, you know, they weren't as structured as we were family-wise, but they were a great group as far as I was concerned to work with. You know, we got along well, made a lot of money, and they knew it was our town. So they didn't, you know, they kept their, they were respectful, let's put it that way. Yeah. You know, I dealt a little bit with the Irish guys on the west side, the Westies. Again, you know, we didn't have any conflicts with them. As a matter of fact, we worked with them from time to time. So no problem there. I never dealt with the Chinese in Chinatown. Didn't have any issues with them. You know, everybody knew not to mess with us. You know, we didn't have any problems with other groups like that. And if we did, we took care of it quickly. And a lot of time was just sitting down with the right guy and saying, hey, these guys were out of line, straighten them out. And that was the end of that. So what you see about groups fighting with each other and all that, it's all nonsense. Even, you know, in the five families in New York, we didn't war with each other. We didn't fight with each other. That ended in the 30s, you know. We didn't have those issues. We worked along with each other. You know, we've had disagreements that we settled amicably in a sit-down, you know. We worked things out. but we didn't go to war with one another. Whenever you saw a war in that life, it was a civil war. It was war over, you know, power, over authority. It was never that all the families joined in together and had a big war. That hasn't happened, like I said, since the 20s and 30s.
Yeah. So would you say then that back now, and probably, I don't know if you're still in the circle of it now, but is the Italian mafia still the most powerful mafia or underworld kind of group in the United States?
Well, you know, I don't think it is what it was back in my day, because in the mid-80s, the government really, you know, they really stepped up their efforts with the Racketeering Act and the Bail Reform Act and Sentencing Reform Act, and they put a tremendous dent in that lifestyle, no doubt. Put a lot of people away, turned a lot of people, made a lot of informants, and took a lot of the power that we had away in the unions and so on and so forth. So, but having said that, it's not going to die in my lifetime. It's still there. It's still viable. Guys are still doing their thing. It's just a little bit different. But, you know, I don't know. Look, if the government continues to keep up, you know, a tremendous pressure, it might be do serious damage to that life. But right now it's still alive and well. And there are still five families and they're still doing what they do. So
do you know who the bosses are? Do you know them personally?
You know, a lot of the guys that I ran with, they're either dead or in prison for the rest of their lives. I mean, really? Just about all of them. Wow. Yeah. So the guys there now that are coming up are younger guys. I probably didn't associate with any of them. I might have knew one or two, but nobody that I'm really familiar with. I mean, obviously my father, I still talk to him. We associate. But he's not really involved either. So, you know, a couple of the old timers I still know, a lot of them is just trying to live out their life and not, you know, not go back to prison where everybody came at one point in time. So I don't get involved. You know, I'm really done with it.
Do you worry about any of these guys like getting upset that you're doing interviews like this or some of the other ones you do? You know, you're not supposed to talk about this kind of stuff, this life, the past that you had, even though you're not involved right now. Do you ever look over your shoulder or kind of worry about, like, you know, someone trying to make a name for themselves?
Well, you know, look, I'm cautious when it comes to things like that because I don't ever underestimate or sell people short. You know, and Justin, I always said I'm not going to make my way in life by talking bad about other people, you know? And I had no real animosity to anybody in that life. You know, I didn't have any really hard, bad feelings with anybody. I just realized the life was coming to it was going to be a real problem. I mean, I saw it happening. Guys were going away for 50, 100 years. You know, the Racketeering Act. I mean, so many informants were coming out of that life. Guys that, you know, I ran with every day. The next thing I know, they're in court testifying against people. So, you know, I just saw that happening, and I wanted to get out of the life. Now, were people upset with me? Of course. You're not allowed to leave that life. I mean, I betrayed my oath by talking about it. But what I didn't want to do is, as a result of my talking, put anybody in trouble. And, you know, I said a lot of things, but they was directed at the life itself. It wasn't directed at anybody in particular, you know, in a large degree. And everything that anybody wants to know about that life, it's all on tape. It's, you know, the Gotti tapes, and he didn't do this intentionally. Obviously, he didn't know it, but there's 2,000 hours of tapes on Gotti and his crew. Everything you want to know about the life is on those recordings. And that could be the same set of a lot of other guys. So, you know, plus they have so many informants out there now that are telling them everything they want to hear. So I'm not giving any new information. I'm really not. And I'm not giving information that's going to hurt anybody. They're not going to shut down the mafia because of Michael Franzese. So, you know, people understand that. And, you know, like I said, though, look, I'm in public. Somebody wants to have an infamy. They want to make a name for themselves. You know, I'm an easy target sometimes. And other times when I go to certain places, I'm cautious and I'm careful because I know that I should be. So, look, I'm not a kid, not a baby. I've lasted pretty long in this life. And hopefully that'll continue.
So with that said, you knew even back then that there was guys flipping all the time. There was guys becoming informants, people that you associated with, people that you did work with all the time were just getting caught and then, you know, diming other people out. Were you worried at the time? Did you have to look over your shoulder at the time thinking that you were going to get caught any day now? Or did you actually, were you able to enjoy like all the money you were making and all the things that you were able